So coming to the fellowship program in clinical preventive and non-invasive cardiology that we are talking about, which is a joint program that we are offering with Medanta and Medvarsity. Now, this is aimed to develop a pool of skilled clinical and non-interventional cardiologists to address the increasing demand for cardiology services, which is exactly the entire discussion we've had so far, to work more towards the preventive aspects of it and leave invasive aspects specifically to probably to the specialists and consultants. So, sir, you already addressed why this program was put together. If you can throw some light on the course, how it was structured, what went into that thought process, why did you decide on certain time frames and certain subjects and topics?
Okay, first let me say that you said non-interventional. Well, we are, even those who are clinical are actually also intervening, in the sense that today, in the field of structural heart disease, and echocardiography has become invasive in echocardiography, that you actually have to do transesophageal echo in the cath lab, in the operating room. So in as much as that is concerned, I think echocardiography is now invasive. The thought process while setting this course was to have a subset of people who will be well versed in the clinical aspects and can at the drop of the hat also do a good echocardiographic examination and get at least a huge part of the diagnosis before rushing him into a radiology lab or something at the bedside, because this is not radiation free. I mean, it's radiation free and it's at the bedside. You can repeat it ad lib and no. Then we said, okay, let's take one step forward, that this is what we've done for the patients in the hospital, but what can we do for people who don't have the disease? And that's wherein came in the aspect of preventive cardiology. I was talking to a young gentleman who had done his MD in community medicine. And he said, you know, I've been looking for a thing like this where I can even take a small machine and do intermammary thickness on 1,000 people. And that actually is what our happy study is, heart attack risk and you, which was also co-authored by Dr. Valentine Fuster, where we just did at the periphery IM, because you know sometimes you can't even get a decent lipid profile done at that level. So I think each word of this course was thought of very clearly. Because people are rushing into the cath lab, so there is a paucity of clinicians. So clinical, preventive, and non-preventive, put these two together, will bind them together. That, yeah, I thought this was mitral aortic stenosis. But see, it turned out to be hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. True. That only the echo will show us. So this person becomes more broad-based, and obviously, and then there are many, many cardiac conditions in which follow-up takes place only through the echocardiography. Aortic regurgitation, mitral valve prolapse, aortic stenosis, a patient with a heart valve implanted, they can only be followed up by echocardiography. Are they deteriorating? Should we operate now? Or no, they are okay. We can follow them clinically. All this cannot be just based on stethoscope.
Right.
You asked where, so each element of this course, actually, that's why we said 2 years is the least person should spend.
Yeah.
And our hospital is, it's high volume center. So the person can go from area to area. Once the person is posted in the clinical area, doesn't mean he cannot go in the evening and see the echoes of his patients. He can do it anytime.
Right.
He can have an assessment.
Right. So for just the benefit of the audience who are looking at the slide, you can clearly see, like Dr. Kasliwal has mentioned, it's a two-year program, very comprehensively designed. So 1 year of clinical studies with 6 months of cardiac intensive care, 3 months of inpatient, 3 months of outpatient, and the one more year deals with 6 months of echocardiography, 3 months of cardiac stress testing and nuclear imaging, and then 3 months of other vascular imaging, atherosclerosis imaging, and the other miscellaneous added topics. And like Dr. Kasliwal has rightly pointed out, there's no reason why the resident or the trainee, doesn't get an opportunity to go back and follow up on his patient's imaging modalities later in the evening once he's done with his clinicals. So the program is well thought out and well structured and designed to exactly fit to the need of the hour that we are talking about. Sir, if you can talk to us about an overview, now that we've understood how it is structured, all three areas of clinical, preventive, and non-invasive is covered in these 2 years. We have seen that. If you have to briefly touch upon the curriculum, probably, just on the slide that I'm showing. Yes. Yeah.
Actually, one thing I forgot.
Yes.
That along with the total hands-on and practical training, there are actually to be 2 to 3 classes per week.
Okay.
So it's going to be a tough course for the mentees.
Sure.
Because they have to prepare, we have to prepare, and journal clubs to get abreast with the knowledge and keep going on that direction.
Sure.
So it's got a, and then they have to fill in their log books, which is also part, and then periodical examinations.
Right.
So even though they're doing a residency, but along with that, they're also deeply involved into clinical work. It's very much like a US-based course where you have semesters,
yeah,
and you have to, yeah, of course, it'll be a very objective analysis. It's not that as if somebody doesn't get through, so it's, no, don't go to the next. No, it's a question of just because there may be knowledge gaps in where they're coming from, whether they are picked up or not. So those knowledge gaps, I and my colleagues, Drs. Mittal and Bansal, will see to it that theoretically we can help them go along. But they will have to have good sense of cases. Three areas where I will especially highlight is the area of heart failure, valvular heart disease, and particularly atrial fibrillation. These are areas in which new thinking is there. We've made a lot of difference to the lives of these people. And I can see this after doing my DM cardiology from AIMS, what we were doing at that point. And now things are so different. Good for the patient.
Yeah.
That's important. So structural heart disease, heart failure, hypertension, and AFib are complex in their methodology for pharmaceutical drugs to be given. I see some weird prescriptions at times. This is where I will do a lot, because this is also prevention. In a sense, this is all prevention. The use of statins, where not to use, what to. So I think it's going to be intensive, not only for me and my colleagues, but also for, not only for the mentors, but also for the mentees. And they have to be prepared for that.
Right, right. But I think all that is needed. So we understand it's going to be an intensive program, which is good. Like Dr. Kasliwal has explained, it's going to be a 4-semester program structured individually as per the topics and curriculum, and all the practical and simulation modules will go hand in hand. We've discussed about the clinical rotations and the thesis and the case report. Sir, you want to throw some light on the thesis that you're expecting as part of the program?
Yes. See, the thesis will be a very brief write-up. Why? I want the people to understand research methodology and do succinct review of literature and then put their head together along with the mentor in a project which he will value later.
Right.
That, you know, I look at risk factors in women below 30, for example, because today women are shoulder to shoulder with men. Are they becoming? Is their smoking a habit? Are they hypertensives? Are they getting? So, but it will teach them the modern methods of research. And that's where Medversity will help us in sending them offline courses, online course, which they can study. For example, the null hypothesis.
Yes.
I mean, they must know what the null is.
Right.
They must know ethics in research.
Right.
And we have a good research as well. They will also take classes.
Right.
But
right.
They don't spend that much time in our thesis. This is going to be a brief dissertation wherein we'll just see how they've evolved, and so that they can continue that later on in life as well. This is just a step we are implanting.
Right. So can you provide the prospective student an idea on how the clinical training environment will be at Medanta, and you know, what are the different training methods? What a typical day for the resident or the trainee would be like with you there?
A typical day will start at their various areas where they're posted, where from the heart command. See, there's teaching right from 8 a.m. They don't have to sit in the classroom, which they will briefly on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, but the teaching starts at the rounds. And that bedside is the real teacher.
Best place to learn.
Because we have a bedside as well, we have a bedside monitor as well, and we have a bedside ECG and our clinical skills with stethoscope. What else do you need to make a wholesome diagnosis?
Yes.
So a typical day will start in the morning at the bedside, a good history taking, they would already have done, and physical examination, the mentor will come and correct them that, look, this is what the finding was, this is how we have to do. And he will put two and two together right there in front of him. So that's how the whole day will go. And then on Mondays, the whole institute gets together for listening to people from other departments. That also is training.
Yes.
Of course. See, a person who's posted on the 9th floor in the clinical area, he doesn't have to, he shouldn't think that he's isolated from the 3rd floor where the heart of echocardiography lies. In between he comes, there are 10 echo labs. He stands and says, okay, is this mantle still? Are you doing a transesophageal? Can I be a part of it? That's all he has to do. And right. He will then get the nuance. The beauty is that he should be able to note that down in his pad and then go read up in the night. So that's why I said it's going to be an intensive program. Two days is not big, too big a time.
And right, and you also spoke about at least 2 to 3 lecture sessions or discussions with the mentors during the week.
Yes.
And the journal club. So it is going to be intensive. Sir, we'll talk a little bit about the final evaluation criteria, because I think that's something the audience would want to know on based on what they will be evaluated. So if you can just speak about that.
Yes. They will be evaluated based on their journal clubs that they've done, their dissertation, and what they've learned. There will be briefly, there may be even small examinations in between.
Right.
The idea with us is not to test what the person doesn't know, but to test what he knows and how well he can get across.
Well said.
That is the basic thing.
Well said.
Because he has to go out and save thousands of lives, and he'll be well equipped to do that.
Yes. But for the benefit of the audience, to test your own acumen and knowledge and understand as you go along the year, there will be online modules and assessments for your own retrospection to understand and go back and prepare where you're struggling. And like Dr. Kasliwal has said, there will be continuous practical teaching and training sessions ongoing. So evaluation is, I think, is not the area. Examination is not the area one should be concerned about. More than we should be looking at the kind of exposure that we can expect here, the kind of mentors and trainers that you would have around. And I don't think there's a best place to learn than that. So that is what we should be focusing on. And of course, certification, there will be a fellowship in clinical, preventive and non-invasive cardiology from us that you will receive. And a 2 years of work experience certificate from Medanta. Correct me if I'm wrong, sir.
Yes, that's correct.
Right. So these are the 2 things the student will be awarded at the end of the year. Process, once we know the eligibility criteria, physicians who've done MD or DNB in internal medicine or family medicine, or for that matter, emergency medicine, are most welcome to apply. Even clinicians who've done PG diploma in clinical cardiology earlier and were already working can also go ahead and apply to take it forward. The selection process will be based on an interview. Once you send across your resumes to us, they will be sent across to the course director's team at Medanta, and they will evaluate, and there will be an interview, a face-to-face interview, and the students will be selected, and it's completely based on their evaluation. Medvarsity will definitely facilitate the process of admission, but the admission call is completely under their jurisdiction, course director's jurisdiction. So it's a simple process. If you're interested, all you need to do is reach out to us and send across your resume. If you're eligible, then we'll send it across to the Medanta team. Sir, I think another important question, now that we've spoken so much about the program and how the students are going to benefit, I think one question everybody would want to know is how this is going to help their careers. That's a very practical question to ask, I think, and I'm sure you would agree as a senior. So yes. If you can just talk about that.
No, it's going to help their careers tremendously, because in any department of cardiology where there is a invasive, non-invasive clinical work going on, they will be sought after because they've dealt with acute pulmonary embolisms, they've dealt with acute dissections of aorta, they've dealt with acute myocardial infarctions, and to triage them into various areas. Then they will be asked that, look, I want to do an angioplasty. Look at the mitral regurgitation. Should I do it? Should I not do it? So they will be central. A clinician will always be in the center of a invasive or a interventional group. And the patients will want to know from them.
Yeah.
And if they're in some bigger centers, they may actually be a part of the structural heart team. That if there is a tower procedure going on, a transaortic valve replacement, well, nothing will happen without them, both before, during, and after the procedure. So they are going to be, to my mind, the backbone of any department. And only then the interventional cardiologist and the cardiac surgeon will come in. Because even in the OT, even in the cath lab, sometimes when the patient becomes sick, the first thing we actually have for our dedicated cath labs, we actually have a dedicated echo machine. So that we can immediately do an echo and say, is there a pericardial effusion? Why is this patient not responding? So their career opportunities will be any good institution. And of course, many of them will say, no, look, I want to be on my own. Then depending upon the area and the state in which you are, you have the PNDT clearances. Of course, in many countries, technicians are doing echocardiography, why would not MD and such people do it, and do it with a gusto, because they know the basic condition for which they're doing it. So they will be at the center of the cardiology world for sure.
Right. That means a lot coming from you, sir, I think, but that's a very valid question.